The one thing I would like to say at the outset is actually most of our challenges have been less with the panchayats and the sarpanches. I mean, there have been some, but on the whole, we have got a lot of support from them, including turning over panchayat rooms to us for our information hubs, which we call Seva Shakti Kendras. But the challenges actually have been with local authorities. The first and perhaps most difficult issue has been getting the information on the schemes and programs. And that might seem strange to us, but when individual women go, or even when teams of women go to the block level or district level, they have to go back and forth, repeated trips, wasting time, energy, and money, as they put it, behen bahut dhakka khana padta hai. They may get a reply, they may not get a reply. It's confusing. To be fair, sometimes the local authorities themselves are confused and they don't have the latest information on the schemes, or suddenly the scheme has changed or there's some tweaking which they're not aware of. The third challenge in developing the collaboration is that often individual women and poor people at the grassroots are given the runaround. So individually, we've learned it's very hard to build these kind of links and collaborations, but collectively, it's easier, and I'll come back to that. Also, I should mention that it's easier for the local authorities when we're building these partnerships and collaborations to deal with the collective. The fourth challenge is the documentation. You know, this is a huge issue in our country. Poor people have to spend so much time and money. It's not clear. They try to find out and collaborate with the local authorities, but again, the documents that are required keep changing, and this requires time, money, and energy. The fifth is digitalization. Now, a lot of these schemes are online, and while most of us would welcome, it's not easy for local people to access online. First of all, especially women, they don't have possession of smartphone. Then there's internet connectivity issues. The sixth issue, which is no surprise, is corruption. Again, almost impossible for individual people at local level, particularly women and vulnerable groups, to buck. Then caste and community and gender discrimination, which is rampant in our country. Some local authorities won't give some of our members the time of day, and our grassroots leaders, they're Dalit or they're Adivasi. They don't even allow them in, forget about getting them sit down and get information. The way forward is through organizing, through collectivizing, through building what we call membership-based organizations, unions, cooperatives, collectives, farmer-producer organizations, because alone she can't manage. But as a group, you know, there's the collective strength and bargaining power, and also it's easier for the local authorities.
So basically, we always try and create a community-based structures. So if the organization is not able to continue their projects or program, but the community-led process can continue by the community workers. And basically, our core belief is ki if we can build the capacity of the the victims, so they can work, become a survivor in their cases. And after that, basically, if we will build again their capacity or like the skills, they can work as a transformative leader in their communities. Organization like us, we can play a role of facilitator, and we can facilitate the processes at the community level. And if we can give the leadership role to the local people from the community, so they can basically work for their own community. And this process is a sustainable process. And it's a very the cost effective process, because we are not investing a lot, but the community is investing their resources, their time to ensure the change at a grassroots level.
The role of different kinds of social structures, organizational behavior that can happen better through groups of people rather than as individuals.
We're talking about what are the constraints, challenges, opportunities of field workers of institutions engaging with the local administration. Now, I would nuance it slightly by saying that there is a sharp difference in terms of what the organizations do, because there are NGOs and there are coalitions and there are campaigns. And therefore, those which are in the development sector broadly, which is into health or education or service delivery, the engagement with the state is of a very different nature than, say, an organization that is human rights based or is fighting for civil liberties at the ground. The biggest challenge for a field worker is access. And in different ways, like Mirai spoke, that coming as part, being part of a seva or a jansahas, what that does is it allows you to have that access. And that's very, very important, because that is the biggest barrier that a local field worker of a smaller grassroots organization faces while dealing with the government. From the government side, therefore, one of the things that I find missing today is to create a larger enabling environment for NGOs to work or civil society to work, and create a narrative of civil society as enablers. Governments, particularly local administration, the only way to engage them is not on rhetoric, not on, of course, at different levels. Suppose you're trying to stop the building of a dam, then obviously that's an entirely different battle. But if you, insofar as engagement with local governments for rights holders and for accessing entitlements is concerned, the more detail you have, the more constructive the engagement. I think that's one critical lesson that we learn. Second, the ability to engage the state critically, even at the field worker level, where you are not just going as a supplicant, where you're not just going as a petitioner, but you're going as a rights holder who can call out the state for inefficiency, corruption. Third is training and capacity building, which is that how much investment have organizations made in training their field workers and engaging the state. And one of the things that we found consistently over the years, as I look through the details, is that building confidence of field workers to engage, your community mobilizes to engage with the state, and ability to communicate effectively with them, your message of change, are two areas where I think are capacity gaps that we as NGOs need to address. And on the other hand, we need enabling legislation from the government. We do not want government to inhibit our ability to spend on capacity building by bringing in laws or regulations which are restrictive, and to recognize that administrative expenses which go into training and capacity building of field workers are actually contributing into this, to this journey of social change.
The idea that to understand something consistently across a large scale, you need a few nuts and bolts, you need to know a few methods. And district by district, whether it was colleges or whether it was NGOs, we found that these opportunities don't exist. Opportunities to come together on a very large scale often are not available to ordinary groups unless they are connected to some bigger network. Opportunities to institutions, individuals of upgrading their skills. Often people don't even know we want the skills.
The critical piece, if I may use that word, and even during COVID that has been amply proven, are the grassroots women leaders, who we in our Gujarati language call agivans, but our seva sisters now across the country say agivans. Basically, these are democratically elected women leaders at the grassroots from all different caste communities, religious minorities, and so on.
In the large scale program that I have implemented, I think getting the values right is number one. If you don't have the values right, and if you're not driven by clear ideological considerations of caste, of gender, you cannot get this engagement right. So I think that is number one that I would say. The second point I would say is what reinforce what Ashif said, that chances of success are greatest when they're from the community. As we used to say, jinke mudde unki ladai, jinki ladai unki agwai, that you people whose fight it is must be there at the forefront of the fight. They must be the one advocating for it. And the third point I would say it has worked is when it's not restricted to a single issue. If a field worker or a frontline field worker actually joins politics at the local level and becomes a panchayat leader or becomes or aspires to become a ZP president, there is nothing wrong in it. We should not see that as something that is inhibitory or that needs to be inhibited, but we need to see that as something that is encouraged.
So the first point about the use of technology. So previously, we are a grassroots level organization and we are not the tech friendly organization. But in last couple of years, basically, we realized the role of technology is very, very important for the community level work and even to engage or mobilize the community and to reach out the community. Co-creation. So if you will co-create the program, if you will co-create the intervention, then the community or the community level, the activists participate very well.
One strategy that has held us in good stead, because Biraj mentioned this, entitlements versus services. I mean, you need both. And as a strategy, not only people need the services, But also when we've learned that when you provide, say, healthcare or childcare, then confronting the local authorities or even eliciting their collaboration and cooperation becomes a little easier because they think, aap log sirf ladai jhagda nahi karte, ye service ka bhi kaam karte. Thank you.